Hello and welcome to TEPSA Explainers. My name is Mark Harwood and I'm Director of the Institute for European Studies at the University of Malta. In today's talk I'm going to speak about Malta-Russian relations, and if there is one main point I would like you to take from today's talk, it is that relations with Russia are not always about energy, and in the case of Malta they have long been about Russian activity abroad, more specifically in Libya. Malta gained independence from the United Kingdom in 1964 and established diplomatic relations with the Soviet Union in 1967. Malta is a two-party political system, so the two parties tend to become polarised on many issues. On foreign policy, the Christian Democrats were primarily pro-West, and in the case of the Social Democrats, they preferred Malta joining the non-aligned movement and also pursuing neutrality. And in fact, in 1980, they register Malta as neutral of the United Nations, and they sign a series of friendship agreements with neighbouring countries, primarily with Libya, but also to the north with Italy. They also signed an agreement at that time with the Soviet Union, and in 1982 Malta established its first embassy in Moscow. However, the relationship after that doesn't really progress, and in fact, even to this day, economic relations between Malta and Russia are not significant. Where Russia is significant is as a source of energy, and at different times Russia has been a major oil and gas supplier, but two EU-funded projects have diminished that dependency, and in fact Malta is now linked through an EU-funded project to the European electricity network, and from 2024 will be part of the European gas network. Far greater significance for understanding Malta-Russian relations, we have to understand Russian involvement in Libya. Libya has always been a key country for Malta, its nearest neighbour to the south. Gaddafi, for many decades, was a cheap source of oil for Malta. And more recently, from 2002, Libya has become an important transit country for irregular migrants who are trying to cross the Mediterranean. Irregular migration now becoming a major foreign policy issue for Malta. For this reason, Malta, after the beginning of the Libyan civil war, along with most of Europe, backed the international backed government in Tripoli, while Russia increasingly favoured the government in Tobruk. This finding each other on opposing sides in a key region for Malta meant that the relationship between Malta and Russia increasingly grew hostile. Malta refused to allow Russian planes to fly across its airspace in 2016. It recalled its ambassador to Moscow after the attacks in Salisbury, and in 2019 it seized over $1 billion worth of Dinar, which were going from Russia to the Tobruk government. Russia increasingly accused Malta of falling victim to Western propaganda, and the result of this was that the relationship almost all intents and purposes stalled. In 2021, with the creation of the National Government of Unity and the fact that both Malta and Russia now are backing the same government, the relationship thawed, and in fact Malta allowed the seized Dinar to be unconfiscated. However, there doesn't seem to be much incentive to prioritise Malta-Russian relations going forward, irrespective of the situation in the Ukraine. Ultimately, Malta is prioritising the fact that it has been greylisted by the FATF, and for this reason, Malta does not want to be seen as a country that harbours irregular financial practices. But also, its inverted commas golden passport scheme has led to an infringement case with the European Commission, and in particular due to the fact that a sizeable number of Russians have applied for this scheme. In fact, after the invasion of Ukraine, Malta suspended the scheme for Russians and Belarusians. So in this way, relations with Russia are not likely to improve irrespective of the situation in Ukraine, but due to other wider issues, even though the situation vis-à-vis Libya sees both countries on the same page. I think what we need to do going forward is to, in particular, invest in supporting the consolidation of ENISA at a European level. We need to have greater fora where we can talk about these horizontal issues which link things like migration and external relations. and also greater discussion of how a post-Putin Russia might look like.